your reading. But the yogis believe the breath to be sacred. The breath to be one of the, or the essentials of life. And there is this myth within yoga that we are born with a predetermined set number of breaths. It's just like a little story. So maybe you got assigned 520 billion trillion and two breaths. You know, and you would have been assigned a number, and you would have been assigned a number. But what isn't pre-specified is how long it takes us to use these breaths. So the yogis say, breathe slowly, breathe deeply, lengthen the lifespan. And there is a bit of a myth, obviously, a bit of a story, but I think there's some semblance of some sort of truth in that. So if you think if we breathe really shallowly, we're not getting as much oxygen in with each breath. So then our heart has to pump more times to get the necessary amount of oxygen around the body to oxygenate the system. So that's what the yogis are just saying, you know, keep an eye on your breath. Keep it long, keep it full, keep it deep, and not too quick. And then the next thing that we learn in the practice of yoga is that the breath reflects the quality of the mind. So if you're stressed, you're busy, you've just raced here from an airport, you're getting over jet lag, you flew all through the night using that recycled air that's in a plane, you know, your mind might be scattered, you know, full, stressed, lots going on in there. And then the breath is often reflective of that, so it'd be shallow, unconscious, more rapid, more breathing up in here in the top lobes of the lungs. But you know, if we're sleeping, the breath becomes shallow, we yawn. So the breath reflects the quality of the mind, but also in turn, the quality of the mind can be affected by the breath. So if we feel nervous before something, we regulate the breath, we can change that feeling of nervousness, we can calm the system down. That's why it's such a fascinating thing that the quality of the mind is reflected in the breath, but the quality of the breath can change the mind. And then in addition to that, you know, the breath is one of the few systems within the body that can be on unconscious control and conscious control. So, you know, you are not having to think about breathing right now, which is fortunate. But you can equally breathe and think about your breathing and control it. So it's this fabulous thing that happens automatically, but you can choose to control as well. And then that, when controlling the breath, works directly into our central nervous system. So, you know, we have the parasympathetic nervous system, the place of rest and relaxation, our sort of default setting. And you have the sympathetic nervous system, the place of fight or flight. So our inhale stimulates more the sympathetic nervous system, so it can enable you to wake up, to enliven the system. Our exhale stimulates more the parasympathetic nervous system, the place of rest. So if you're wanting to calm down, you're wanting to prepare to sleep, you really want to be focusing on that exhale. Yeah. So, wanted to have a little look at the anatomy of the lungs. So, I'm going to set something else to give you. With the anatomy of the lungs. If we just briefly go through it, you can think of the respiratory system in the lungs as like a tree upside down. Okay. So I have the windpipe, any GPs, feel free, or anybody else, to correct me at any point if I go off piece. Okay. So you have your windpipe coming down here, which we call the trachea. So you can imagine your windpipe, your trachea, as like the main trunk of a tree. Down. Okay. And then this splits off into two main branches, which is your bronchus. So we have the trunk of a tree and then two main branches that come off the bronchus. And then off those two main branches come these smaller branches, which are called the bronchi. And then they break off into all even smaller branches, maybe little twigs, which are your bronchioles. Okay, so I've got a big trunk of my trachea, two big branches coming down here, my bronchus, okay, then coming off into smaller branches of the bronchii, and then even smaller branches still of the bronchioles. And then splitting off into what I like to think of little leaves at the bottom. Okay. And all of these leaves that cover all of this are called the alveoli. And the alveoli are completely covered in a network of capillaries, blood capillaries. If you were to unravel all of these capillaries, it would cover the surface area of a tennis court. Mm-hmm. So you have the quantity, the surface area of a tennis court, in your lungs, predominantly there to deal with the gas exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide. Okay? And they're so thin, these capillaries, that your blood cells have to line up one after the other in single file to get through them. We have our tree, trachea, two main branches, then smaller branches, then smaller branches, then the leaves covered in the capillaries. And the capillaries are there for the gas exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide. So this structure of the lungs then sits in a double-walled sac called your plephora. And it's this sac that's really important, the plephora. So the plephora is what attaches to your diaphragm. And the diaphragm is the predominant muscle used in breathing. Okay. Plephora also attaches to the thoracic cavity. So, let's grab my dude. I haven't got a name yet. Okay. So, the plephora, the sac of my lungs, is sitting in here and it attaches to the diaphragm, this dome here, and also into the thoracic cavity. So that's when I inhale, the diaphragm moves down, contracts, pulling on the plephora, the sac, that's then expanding the lungs. The intercostal muscles pull the ribs out, the ribs pull out, pulling on the sac, expanding the lungs. Then I draw the oxygen, or the air in and the air out. Does that make sense? So, then I predominantly wanted us to look at the diaphragm. The diaphragm is the key muscle used in breathing. So your diaphragm is this dome that sits in here. Okay? And you can think of it almost like the shape of a parachute. Now what I think is amazing to know about the diaphragm is it's really freaking huge. Okay? So your diaphragm in here, it attaches to the xiphoid processes, this collagenous structure at the end of the sternum, so it's attaching here. Then it attaches to ribs 12 to 6, okay? It's attaching here, it's attaching, if you feel this on your body, if you try and find the 12th rib, try and find as far down as you can. So, find your sternum, so it's attaching at the xiphoid processes at the end of the sternum, then it's attaching from rib 6 all the way down to rib 12. I mean, that's a real depth, okay? The diaphragm covers that depth. Then it comes all the way around the back, and attaches to T12, okay, the end of the thoracic spine. And then there's this appendage that comes all the way off it. It's called a little, I can never pronounce it, crura. 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 And the crura comes all the way down and attaches to L4. Okay, it's attaching right down nearly at the base of the spine. So if you can think of that again, like the diaphragm covers here, it's all through here, all through these ribs, attaches all the way around here, and then sends its appendage all the way down here. Like, that's huge. Okay. So imagine this huge diaphragm inside of you there, which is responsible for your breathing. Where's my umbrella? Right. One diaphragm, okay?
diaphragm, and it has a central tendon in the middle. Oh, central tendon. Helpful. Okay. And then off that comes all these fibril attachments. I've got my one here coming to my sternum and coming out here through my ribs. And I've got this one here coming round to T12. And what's this? Crura. Coming all the way down and hooking at the long spine. Does that make sense? Okay. But then lots of people really don't use that powerful, wonderful muscle anywhere near enough when breathing. So I taught someone one-on-one this morning and all the breathing was inhale up, exhale down. Whereas we know in yoga we're inhaling, the diaphragm moves down. Movement here, and that's really common. I can't even get my mum to breathe diaphragmatically, all right? But most yogis do. So if you think of that diaphragm right in there, the average diaphragm contracts on the inhale, releases on the exhale, and that movement in the average person can move about 3 to 5 centimeters. Okay? On someone with really developed lung capacity, a really strong breather, it can move up to 8 centimeters within your body. Okay. And then if you think you've got the diaphragm here and below it sits all the digestive organs, and all of the reproductive organs, it's pretty crowded in here. Okay. Above, heart and lungs. Okay. So as this moves down, my 3 to 5 or 8 centimeters, all of this is getting really compressed and squished, which is why the belly balloons out on the inhale. Okay. And as it comes back up, everything settles back down, and it softens. So, coming up to stand, interlace your fingers. You can do a seated as well, you don't have to stand. And you're gonna bring the fingers kind of just below the nipple line, and elbows just splayed out a little bit. Then as you inhale, you want to move your hands down like this, elbows come up, thinking of that as the diaphragm dome moving down. And as you exhale, the diaphragm lifts up. Inhale, diaphragm. Exhale, diaphragm. 3 more. Diaphragm as you breathe there, mirroring it with the hands. So, another way to feel the diaphragm, many of you have done Kapalabhati breath, which we're not going to do now, but that pumping from here. So I want you to bring 2 fingers and find your sternum here at the ribs joint, and then come down a little bit. So you come down about 1 inch, and then like a snake, go. Everyone needs to. Can you feel that movement behind here? Right. So that is what you're feeling. It's this really powerful muscle here. Does anybody here sing? Yeah. So it's that same thing. It's like really trying to use the strength of the diaphragm as you, that same and then you let sound come out and really think on engaging in here. Not just this bit, but all the way around here, all the way around here, and all the way down here. Which is why there's such fascinating research being done now on people that hardly use their diaphragm when they breathe. And guess what? They have back problems. Fascinating relationship between the diaphragm breathing and back issues. So I want you to feel this full movement now of the diaphragm, this all the way around. So you're I'm going to rise this down.
So I want you to do your strap part around you. Again, you can explore this seated as well if you would prefer. So you want to do your strap up tight enough that it stays in place, but not tight, because otherwise it's actually going to restrict the movement of your ribs. So I've got a quite loose there, but tight enough that it's staying up. Now you just want to drop it down a bit, so you're sort of around this area here, so a little bit lower than the sternum. Kind of around rib, sort of 8, 9. And then come into Tadasana with any neutral shape. Relax the arms by the side. And think about that breathing. Inhale, the diaphragm contracts, moves down. Exhale. Now see if you can feel the ribs. So now we're using the intercostal muscles as well. Expand out in all directions. See if you can feel it evenly against the strap. Okay. You need to do the strap up slightly tight to do. You'd also be aware if the strap is restricting you. So you should feel that the strap's firm enough that you can breathe into it, but not so firm it's restricting you. You want to think even expansion into all parts of the strap. Now, in a moment, we're going to draw the arms up overhead. Just that simple lifting of the arms up is going to help to lift and open the top lobe of the lungs. So it might be slightly easier to take a deeper breath here. It might not. Okay, so we're going to inhale, draw the arms up, Urdhva Hastasana, so palms face each other. Drop the shoulders. And then breathe out into the lungs in all directions. Push into the strap evenly in all directions. And exhale, fold forwards. And step back to downward facing dog or all fours if you prefer. Upside down the tree. It's actually the right way up now, if you would think of it as a tree. So feel the breath here. Can you keep it even? Pushing into all parts of the strap evenly. Take one more breath. Drop down onto the knees. Sit back on the heels if possible, if not, just sit onto the bottom. Close the eyes. And again, breathe into the strap evenly, 3 breaths. Front, side, back. Good. Open the eye. Release the strap. Were you able to keep even pressure around all of the strap? Where did you find it more? Front, side, back. The back I definitely find harder because if you think the intercostals are drawing way more here and I've got way more movement at the front of the ribs. But there is some awareness of the back. You know, it does join T12, L4. So you should be able to feel something in the back. And joining so far down L4, it's why it's, you know, like
You really try and shift the breath into the back body. You can sometimes even feel some awareness of the breath right down into the tailbone. Real subtlety of breath. You will feel more easily. Okay. Any questions on that so far? Kind of a little bit for that. Alright, here. Okay. So this picture is done by something called Franklin Method. And we've actually got a Franklin Method teacher coming into this course on the last weekend. Those who are doing teacher training, the Franklin Method teacher is doing all of our anatomy. So if you just, I've got five of these printed off. What I want you to see on this is here's that parachute of the diaphragm. You can really sort of consider the huge size of it. I'm going to pass this around in a second. And what you can't see here, but you'll see when it's closer to you, is I've got a dotted line here with some arrows. I've got a dotted line here with some arrows. So what this picture is showing you is the lungs and the diaphragm on an inhalation. So that picture is full inhalation. Where the dotted arrows are is where the lungs and the diaphragm would be at the end of an exhalation, at resting. Okay. So it just gives you a really nice visual. You can see the movement of the intercostal muscles taking the side of the lungs out and the movement of the diaphragm. So if you just pass that around. When we look in yoga, the default breath, the breath that comes before all pranayama, the breath that's used in all practice, is the full yogic breath, or sometimes called the complete breath. And then once we've nailed that technique of breathing, our breathing exercises are layered on top of that, but everything has the full yogic breath. So in the full yogic breath, the diaphragm moves down, the ribs, the intercostals move out, and subtly, the collarbones lift up. Just so you're making sure that you're expanding right into these top lobes of the lungs, and if you just bring your hand up to your collarbone, and then just drop immediately below the collarbone, so your top lobes of your lungs come all the way up here. Okay, so the lungs are all the way up here to erect down here. Okay, they come a lot higher than sometimes I think we realize. The density of the alveoli, where the gas exchange happens, there's more density of those leaves down in the bottom part of the lungs. There's still some up here. So you want that full yogic breath, which means expanding the lungs to what is our maximum. We need to diaphragm down, intercostals, ribs out, collarbones, top lobes up. So, relax the hands down. Close the eyes. Just think of that full yogic breath. So inhale, first third, diaphragm moves down, belly expands. Second third, ribs expand in all directions. Third, collarbones lift up, expanding top lobes of the lungs. And then release. I'm going to come back to that in a second. So this next exercise, you can either do it seated, or if you want to stand, come and do it standing. So you're going to focus on just the right side of the lung. So I want you to take your left hand and just gently tap from right up here at the base of the collarbone, coming all the way in, so you're covering that whole area. And then you slowly work your way down. And you can sit with a gentle tapping, or you can make a bit more of a fist and turn it into a little bit more of a pummeling. And coming a little bit further down, covering that whole lung area, coming all the way down to sort of last third of the ribs. And remember, you're coming around the side. The back is way more awkward. Okay, but there's the back to it. I'm just focusing on this right side of the lung.
pretty sure it's the right way around. So the right lung has three lobes, the left lung has two lobes. Give it a couple more minutes if you get down the side.
Moment.
A little bit more of the back. And then relax that arm down. Close the eyes. And just notice first structurally if the right hand side of you feels any different. The shoulder maybe. Shoulders often dropped a lot lower. Now as you take your full yogic breath, belly, ribs, chest. You're aware of any more expansion in one side of the lung to the other. Do the left lung. Does it feel any different? Yeah. Your shoulders look amazingly different. That's a bit spooky. I looked at your shoulders straight away and then looked at them again. Okay, so we'll even up. I always like it standing.
Were you awake or asleep when we did this crazy earlier on the beach ago?
There's different air in here. Moments where make sure you get enough of the back. And relax it down. Compare the right side of the body to the left side. Oh, Claire's shoulders are now even. Full yogic breaths as you inhale, the diaphragm descends, ribs expand, collarbones lift. And exhale. Two more full yogic breaths. One of the reasons yoga is so good for us when we're looking at the breath and the respiratory system is that it really strengthens, there's a fancy word for it, pulmonary function. How powerful our exhale is. So it really strengthens the breath because right now we've been either sitting or standing and we've prepared by lying with the chest open in really easy places for the lungs to breathe. But obviously we don't stay like this in yoga. We then come into life. And my lungs have just compressed my diaphragm, just restricted one side of the intercostals. This side's quite nice and open. And then we go, hey, could you breathe deep? And I'm really having to choose to work those muscles. If I just breathe normally here, my breath gets stuck. Gets right stuck at the diaphragm. And then what else do? We then go upside down. You know, even if it's just downward facing dog, you know, let alone adding on things like shoulder stand, headstand, and then I'm having to work my whole system upside down. It wasn't built in mind with me spending much time upside down. And then add things like focus pose. You know, this one here.
where I'm really working to expand
the diaphragm down into the belly. So this is the stuff that really strengthens the lungs. And there was a really interesting article, I can't remember where I read it a little while ago, that said we should measure people's age by their pulmonary function, okay, rather than when you were born, by how strong your lungs and your breath are. Okay, so we're going to do locust pose, if you desire it, bow on a bolster, and a twist. Okay, and full yogic breath in them. So, if you don't fancy doing locust pose, just stay seated, interlace the hands behind your back, and do it right there. Okay, otherwise that just opens it up, it won't do the work. So come and line up the tummy. Interlace the hands behind your back. If at any point I've kept you in too long, just come out. So roll the shoulders open, lift the chest, lift the legs, up into Salambasana Locust. And if you need to come out at any point, do, but now just focus on the breath. Inhale, deep diaphragmatic belly breath. Push the belly into the ground. Exhale, softens and you lower slightly. Or you can come all the way out if you desire. Then big inhale, expand, diaphragm down. Abdominal digestive organs move down, they push into the ground, and then it softens. Good, once more. Okay, release it all the way down, just flop for a moment, take your rest. So it's not easy to breathe fully there. Do you agree?
But then it's not really easy to take a nice deep one.
It's not easy.
And that's why it's good.
And then just push back up onto your elbows. Claire, I stole your bolster. I'll give you back in a second. So, again, if this feels too strong because we haven't really done any warm-up, don't worry about it. Let's just prove real quick. So, otherwise, don your ass in a bow on a bolster. So, I want the bolster kind of, it's a bit personal for everyone. So, it's between the top of my hips and the bottom of my ribs. Let's just propping me up. I'm in my back bend. Bend my legs, take a hold, and on your ass in a bow. Way less effort. But then I've got that feedback of that to really push my diaphragm into and breathe against. So if you can't get up, you've got it kind of in the wrong place. So it goes in the middle. If you're tall, you might get some choice. So I said a bit of high for you. So it should be doing a lot of the work. So Lucy had it too high up, we went more down the belly. Sarah as well, yeah. More down the belly, yes. More down to the belly. Yes. Oh, yes. Lucy Joe was about comfort. Nice. And now focus the breath, use the bolster for feedback. One more breath if you can. Release. Roll the bolster away. Come and sit on your butt. I hope that makes you feel weird in the tummy.
Yeah.
A bit nauseous.
Yeah, a little smile hurts.
Standing both legs out in front, come and sit on your butt. So I'm going to come into that twist. That's Indrasana. Ardhasandrasana. So bring your right leg in. Step your right leg up and over your left. That's all you really need. But if you want to wrap that leg round with a full pose, go ahead. Now you're going to hug round with your left arm. Can I just swap the leg there? Spare hand behind you. Inhale, sit tall. Exhale, firm the belly in and up. And then turn. So as soon as I firm that belly in and up, it becomes hard for me to breathe diaphragmatically. As you inhale, you back off slightly. And exhale, you turn. You notice the breath is not easy here. That doesn't mean you just breathe shallowly. You still really try to work the full yogic breath. Take it to the other side. Bring the left leg up and over. Wrap the right one round. Hug round with the right arm. Spare hand behind you. Inhale, sit tall. Exhale, come into that spinal rotation. And work that diaphragmatic breath. Again, if you think about the diaphragm, you're doing a thoracic rotation here in the mid-lap of the back, and the diaphragm is joining to T12. So you are putting strain under that diaphragm whilst it's trying to contract to inhale. Let alone the restriction of the intercostal muscles on the right-hand side. These are the poses you need to work the breath the most. Not go, it's hard to breathe, so I'll breathe shallow. And okay. In addition to those, anything that takes the lungs upside down, puts my wrong way up facing tree, the right way up, really helps to stimulate the alveoli, so those leaves, on the bottom parts of my lungs. So if you think of the alveoli, they're like these little air sacs, okay? And there's loads of them. Does anybody know how many? Like just loads, an unfathomable number.
Right, how many leaves are there on a tree? It's a similar
yeah,
thing.
Exactly.
I think the analogy between leaves and alveoli is brilliant.
Really yeah. Works.
People always talk about flowers, but and leaves are better, I think. Well, there's 30,000 bronchioles in each lung, and then the leaves attached to the alveoli, so there's a lot. And some of these little air sacs just don't expand. Okay? They're just like tired leaves. They just don't do their job. And some of those really are right down here in the bottom part that don't expand. So when we go upside down, I'm going, come on, open up. Okay. So it can help to improve the number of alveoli that are functioning well and fully. So that's when something like shoulder stand or any inversion, headstand, that's why they call these some of our king, so shoulder stand and headstand, they're called the king and queen asanas. And even things like, we're not going to do it, but at home, if you want to be really focusing on the lungs, is shoulder stand at the wall. You know, take the effort of it out. So you come in, you just take this half shoulder stand here, and think about my trees the right way up now. Just kind of open little sacks. Okay. Way less effort than the normal one. Right. Any questions? Once you have the full yogic breath down, then in yoga they go, right, now you're ready for pranayama. And in some of the schools of yoga, like take Shivananda, I'm very interested to see what your teacher did on this, because old school Shivananda, you're not allowed to do pranayama, the breathing exercises, until you've had at least 2 years practice. Were you, because you've had Shivananda teachers, haven't you?
Yeah.
Did you do breathing exercises, pranayama?
Yeah, that's almost straight away.
Yeah. So it's the very old school Shivananda teachers go, oh my god, this thing is so revered, until you have learnt to breathe properly, we're not doing any pranayama with you, but I think a lot of that has changed. Okay. So when we start to come into the pranayama and the breathing exercises, we come into the bandhas. So you have a page in here about the bandhas. So you have padabandha, which is a lift in the foot. You have Mula Bandha, which is the lift of the pelvic floor, pelvic diaphragm. Uddiyana Bandha, which is the belly button pulling back and up, so you have got this in your book. And then Jalandhara Bandha, which is the diaphragm in the throat. And you get sort of chin goes down, base of the skull goes back and up. So these bandhas, they're seen as lifts, little sort of plugs that help to keep the prana, that extra prana, in within the body. Now, in some schools of yoga, you're told right from the beginning to engage Uddiyana Bandha, the belly pulls back and up. So I want you to sit there now and pull your belly button back and up. Keep your belly button pulled back and up and take a diaphragmatic breath. You can't. because you've stopped that diaphragm moving. So that's why, especially in the styles of yoga I teach, we soften everything on the inhale, so everything can expand. And then on the exhale, you feel this lift of the pelvic floor, pelvic diaphragm, belly pulls back and up. So I want you just to focus on these two, Mula Bandha, pelvic floor, pelvic diaphragm, and Uddiyana Bandha, belly pulling back and up. And actually, you can think of these like an elevator in a shop mall, coming up, okay? And it's helping to push the breath up and out. The more fully you exhale, empty the lungs, the better your inhale is. So if you relax everything on the inhale, and as you exhale, think about it's like you're trying to stop peeing mid-pee. Squeeze in, up, belly in and up, diaphragm presses up. You expel the air up and out. Release everything, inhale. Exhale, it's like trying to stop peeing midstream. Pull in and up, belly in and up, diaphragm up. Inhale, release. And exhale, pull up. Release, let go. So that gets layered on top of the full yogic breath. And then on top of that, we'll layer on the ujjayi breath, the audible breath. But hey, we'll just stick with the bandhas. Do you want me to open a window, Penny, or a door?
All the breathings make me hot.
Joey, how's your temperature, huh? Yeah, are you cold?
No, I'm okay.
Okay, I'm just going to open that door for a tick.
It's not really cold in here. It's great. It's Jimmy. I don't want to freeze us then. Open the window, but that might help for a bit.
So, that is one way of using the bandhas. The next complication when you come into pranayama is to add what's called a kumbhaka. So who remembers what a kumbhaka means?
The pause.
Yeah. Okay, so it's a breath retention, or a pause is actually a much better word. We say things like breath retention, which sounds a very firm word, or hold, which implies this holding of the body. Actually, it is a pause, just a cessation in breathing with as minimal effort as possible. So the first one to focus on is we're going to inhale, pause. Exhale without pause. Okay. So on the inhale, I want you to relax everything. But then at the end of the inhale, before the pause, I want you to squeeze pelvic floor and pelvic diaphragm in and up. So if you can imagine a balloon, I want you to blow up the balloon and then tie a knot on the end. Okay? Mula Bandha. So inhale, relax everything, blow up the balloon. Then squeeze in and up, pelvic floor, pelvic diaphragm. So you're just holding in that air. Everything else is soft, chest is soft. Then untie the knot at the bottom of the balloon, then breathe out. We won't pause at the bottom, then we just take another inhale. Mula Bandha, squeeze pelvic floor, pelvic diaphragm. Release, then exhale. Couple more. And other than squeezing Mula Bandha, try and let everything else be as gentle, as relaxed in your body as possible. So you don't think about holding or retaining. As Tracy just said, just pause. The word for inhalation is puraka. Okay. So kumbhaka means hold. So the practice of holding the inhalation is a puraka kumbhaka. Practice of holding the inhalation. You engage Mula Bandha, you tie the knot at the end of the balloon. Okay. An inhale stimulates the sympathetic nervous system, so that is the more energizing, enlivening breath. So now we're going to do the opposite, and for this one, you're going to inhale, change, no pause, exhale, and then to help me there, I engage Mula Bandha, so squeeze, Uddiyana Bandha, because they've helped me exhale, and then chin to chest, Jalandhara Bandha. Okay, so you engage all of the bandhas when you hold out and exhale. So remember, you engage these to push out, and then you just go up at the end. Take a big inhale, diaphragmatically. Then as you exhale, squeeze Mula Bandha, Uddiyana Bandha, pushing the exhale out. When you've got rid of all exhale, chin to chest, and hold that exhale out. Aside from holding your bandhas, try to relax everything else. Then before you inhale, you've got to release the bandhas, then inhale. As you exhale, squeeze Mula Bandha, pelvic floor, pelvic diaphragm. Uddiyana Bandha, belly pulls back and up. Then Jalandhara Bandha, chin to chest. Hold the exhale out. And only when you're ready, release the bandhas, inhale. Three more times. Exhalation is the parasympathetic. That is the more soothing breath on the nervous system, although actually it feels more effort to me, that one. So an exhalation is called a rechaka. So a hold of an exhale, rechaka kumbhaka. You don't need to know. Right. So you can see that when you actually start to apply the full yogic breath, apply the bandhas, pranayama is not easy. And all of those should then be present when I'm then doing things like, you know, Nadi Shodhan or Surya Bhadana. But actually good pranayama is technically quite challenging. Okay. Any questions on any of that? Did it make sense? Okay, so there's not much more to cover on it. So the only other things we need to talk about is there's two words that are given with the instruction of pranayama. Digha and sukshma, long and steady, smooth and subtle. So the breath, the pranayama, bless you, should be long and steady. That doesn't apply to Kapalabhati. Okay. Smooth and subtle, with the breath becoming imperceptible. Now, did you read in your homework about the... Did anybody try it whilst reading? How close did you get?
Not close at all.
Okay. So, you're going to do full yogic breath. So, inhale, everything's relaxed. Exhale, you use the bandhas to control. Exhale. Lick your hand. Now, how close can your hand get to your face without you feeling the coolness of your breath? So you might want to start. It's a little further away. So close the eyes, it'll help you notice the sensation on your hand. And it will be engaging the bandhas. It really enable you to control the breath. The exhale is going to take forever. Do as many as you feel comfortable to, maybe three or four. If you're uncomfortable after one, just leave it there. Banders on the exhale, the more you control that stream of breath, the closer you'll get the hand. One more if you can. That is a really good technique. The other one works really well. I had a music teacher when I was a kid used to make us do this. How close you can get to a mirror without fogging up. That's a really good breath control trick. Okay, I think he's just bored of knowing people. Okay. So, yeah, keep playing with that and keep, I mean, and this is the practice of pranayama, an imperceptible breath. And you see how slow your exhale had to be to not fog that up? So as I say, you have a set number of breaths. What's not predetermined is how long it takes you to use them. So, now we finish with our experiments. So, there is many a claim that yoga lowers the heart rate and lowers blood pressure, especially the breaths that focus on the exhale and the hold on the exhale. So what you'll see me teach most often is the double time breath, when you say inhale for the count of four and exhale for double the length of the inhale or even longer. You know, sometimes I'll inhale for four and with practice I can get my exhale to about 20. And so just the longer you get it, the more you're calming down the system. According to the textbooks, the more you're lowering the heart rate, the more you're lowering blood pressure. Opposite, things like Kapalabhati should really stimulate the system. So, I have no idea the easiest way to do this because we're not going to be able to measure everyone, but you should be able to take your own pulse if you're not not attached to a monitor. So you should just find the thumb side, bring two fingers, and just drop them down a bit, and then you can use a timer on your phone to count it. Or if some of you got those really clever phones with a heart rate monitor on them. Yeah. Okay. Alrighty. Or if you haven't been to the GP yet, should we stick with, let's take the same people. Who went to the GP first? Okay. So if you, right, good. So if you go and see the doctor, okay, and let's take half of you, so two of you are going to do Kapalabhati. Do you remember, do you guys remember Kapalabhati? Okay, so we're all going to do Kapalabhati, but we're going to test two of them. And then we're all going to do double time breath, and then we're going to test two of them. Okay? All right. So, go to the doctor. Put the heart rate monitor, put the blood pressure cuff and everything on them first.
We can use the oximeters if you want to, just to do the pulse rates.
Yeah,
so that's easy, we'll get a quicker response.
Okay. Should we do that on other people too?
Okay. We've only got two. Okay. We've got
so let's put heart rate, let's put blood pressure monitor on two people, and finger thingies on other people. Two more people. Yes.
I'll put the heart rate monitor on. Is that okay?